Thanks to this record, as a very young kid, I had a clear concept of what a jungle was and that it felt like this. It didn't occur to me that these promising muted chords were played by common brass instruments or an oboe. To me, this simply was the sound of a jungle. A purely Western exotic fantasy, of course, which had nothing to do with any real forest, much less Madhya Pradesh in India. Jungle to me was a dreamlike interior realm I could lose myself in. Evocative images were prompted by this dreamy, breathing groove and the sinuous, haunting melody. Played by a low-key instrument that turned out to be a bass flute. Naturally, my imagination was guided by the film stills in books. So when I finally saw the Jungle Book, my imaginary jungle was enhanced, not destroyed. But then, I saw Goliath 2 on TV. Although that jungle looked more modern, it felt kind of similar. Even beyond the general mood. It started to dawn on me that some of what I thought was unique to the Jungle Book had already appeared in Goliath 2 7 years earlier. And then again. Soon enough, I found myself immersed in the mysterious jungle of film music. Could it be that these alternating flutes were just a standard musical convention of what a forest at night sounds like? If your only reference were these re-released Disney features, it certainly looked like that. They were all directed by Wolfgang Reitherman, who institutionalized the reuse of animation from earlier films. More importantly, George Bruns was the composer on all these features and some shorts like Goliath 2. But beyond those catchy tunes, his scores reveal a lot about conventional underscoring. Walt Disney hired George Bruns in 1953 to adapt Tchaikovsky's Sleeping Beauty ballet for the animated film version. As a self-taught arranger and composer who played 15 instruments, Bruns quickly got what Disney was after. He also understood that Disney liked music through everything, that he liked very melodic music, but that he couldn't stand anything high-pitched. It's no wonder then that Bruns transposed some of the Tchaikovsky tunes down to a lower key. It doesn't come as a surprise either that the Tchaikovsky adaptation influenced Bruns' whole career at Disney. Bruns came up with similar music
Thou sword of truth flies swift and sure
for similar situations.
Oh, ho, ho, I win!
Dramatic string tunes like this, however, are relatively rare. As the Disney films of the 1960s and 70s were a lot more upbeat than the sentimental earlier ones. Bruns still used the strings to evoke the warmth of love. But the romantic expression of sadness was later restrained into an economical descent. Picked up by a wailing oboe and then relieved by a soothing flute. Based on their inherent tone colors, Bruns often used the oboe for its melancholic potential. And the flute for its soothing softness. This iconic descending sadness cue, however, was reserved for central relationships.
Howdy. I'm sorry, lad.
I'm afraid it's all up to us.
Sorry, I spoiled everything.
Ringo,
I know they should have been. It means a great deal to you.
Yes?
Oh, it's not
it's
your
Twilight
fault.
Bach.
I shouldn't have popped
Twilight
off.
Bach, but dear, that's
now
only
I'm really done for.
Darling, it's the very fastest way to say news. Spot.
Specifically, turning points in that relationship.
Mowgli, try to understand.
Despite the reuse, this choice affects how we feel. So, what if Bruns had scored it more dramatically? Would it then feel more like a cheat that Baloo is actually alive? Should the ending imply hope? Maybe even wink at us? Bruns chose the opposite route.
Now. I know how you feel. But you must remember, Mowgli, greater love.
Since Robin Hood's death is no option anyway, it ends in classic Mickey Mousing. Which means that the music closely mimics the visual action.
In fact, that is why I am here.
When George Bruns was first hired to adapt Sleeping Beauty, Disney allegedly told him, "Usually we catch everything. We Mickey Mouse the action." But in this, we just wanna play Tchaikovsky and let it feel the action. In some scenes, the animation was choreographed to the music. But in others, Bruns did catch the action on screen quite closely. Although this still sounds like Tchaikovsky, it is classic Mickey Mousing or underscoring, where the music is dictated by the movement on screen. Duplicating what we already see, like musical braille. Even when underscoring had gone out of fashion in Hollywood, Disney features still relied mostly on music, adding only the most essential sound effects. So when the music stops, they tend to feel empty, devoid of any oral environment.
After five already.
Now, simplicity had always been key to Disney music. But Bruns composed especially transparent, which makes it easy to deconstruct the nuts and bolts of Disney's house style based on short phrases lined up like beads on a string. Usually, Bruns avoids competing tunes, only one melody with basic harmonies. Sometimes just a solo instrument, with pauses for sound effects. At its most basic level, Mickey Mousing consists of short ascending and descending phrases that duplicate the movement on screen
. Now develop your brain, knowledge, wisdom, there's the reason. Primaries.
Reflect an emotional state of mind.
Here come
the tiger.
The man, Village.
Oh.
enough. Please.
Oh, I say here. Take mine.
Or create tension using chromatic lines.
Yes, sir. And I shall lead the other squad.
That gravitate towards a tonal resolution. The same goes for these more elaborate Bruns favorites.
I'm a lot tougher than some people think.
No. Quick! Did you see him?
The phrases are often resolved by musical accents that punctuate an action on screen.
No.
As we've heard before, timbre or tone color, and therefore instrumentation, is essential to this kind of underscore. Just listen how these rocks change weight in the music. Disney composers often took their music through the registers. Overall, Bruns apparently favored the woodwinds. Unfortunately, I don't know what influence Franklin Marx or Walter Sheets had on the choice of instruments. But since the general impression remains constant regardless of the orchestrator, I assume that a lot was determined by Bruns himself. In general, he relied on our intuitive association of high-pitched or soft instruments with small, light or gentle things. Lower registers to older, heavier or villainous characters. But what about him? Low register because he's an elephant? No.
Preposterous.
It's crucial that we see him as a young child.
He'll get hurt if we don't.
But there is room for remarkable ambiguity.
Ka!
Like the solo flute that captures the shiftiness of Ka so well. Sometimes, specific timbres represent interacting characters. Despite the seemingly piecemeal approach, Bruns included elaborate thematic material in his underscoring. This jaunty tune, for example, is first connected to Pongo.
The puppies are here!
How many?
And then extended to all Dalmatians.
Sergeant, I say sod!
Surprisingly, Bruns worked very few of the Sherman Brothers song themes into his scores.
I must go to fetch the water till the day that I am grown.
In the Jungle Book, he only used the girl's siren song.
You're going back to the man village right now.
As a wistful theme.
Not going.
No.
For Mowgli's journey to the man village. oboe and English horn bring out the melancholy of the minor key. When we finally meet the girl, the now familiar melody is still in a minor key, but the warm timbres outshine the sadness. In a less melodic way, the music foreshadows a threat that only appears in the final act.
Shere Khan will surely kill the boy.
Bruns further shapes our expectations of the tiger by emphasizing the fear his name induces.
Shere Khan.
The tiger? What's he got against the kid?
But unlike Cruella, Shere Khan, like that comical wolf, arrives on Silent Pause. Once again, a soft bass flute evokes foreboding and mystery. The basic concept is not so far from this, yet the mood is pretty different. Tremolo and trills are an effective cliché of musical anticipation. They can feel paralyzing,
3, 4,
as well as frantic. With more pronounced alternations, frantic ostinatos, often in a circular form. Extreme situations with the full force of the brass register. But even in chases, Bruns keeps it transparent. One statement after the other, more modular than the overall melodic arc of an Ollie Wallace score.
I beg your pardon.
Allegedly, Bruns had a peculiar sense of humor. Obviously, he was very fond of the roaring glissando. Making this one of his trademarks. This predilection for meaty brass glissandos might have something to do with the fact that Bruns came from a jazz background, and was an avid Dixieland bass player, both on the tuba and the trombone. In the Aristocats, he scored suspense scenes with a stripped-down jazz rhythm. had in the Jungle Book, he used a drum groove devoid of instrumental pattern. While such old-time swing illusions were already considered old-fashioned or timeless by then, these Beatles-type vultures marked a rare foray into contemporary music. Surprisingly, Bruns's bare-bones beat band imitation works just fine with his sparse, greenish backyard of the jungle. The half-hearted country elements of the Americanized Robin Hood, though,
run for it, lassie. This is
sound pretty inconsequential.
Hey, who's driving this flying umbrella?
Bruns was definitely more comfortable with marches, often harking back to his Tchaikovsky adaptation. In contrast to these interchangeable fanfares, back then every film featured a new Buena Vista fanfare, that matched the key and mood of the following overture. Ideally, opening a musical bracket that would be closed by the final chords. And by the final chords of this journey through the jungle of film music, what initially felt so exotic and opaque, hopefully sounds a lot more familiar and transparent, owing a lot to the grounded, swinging and conservative compositional style of this big, easygoing American called George Bruns.